Okay, and the next item of business is a debate on motion 14485 in the name of Siobhan Brown on Judicial Factors Scotland Bill at stage one. I'd invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Siobhan Brown to speak to and move the motion. Minister, around 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Law Commission do an important job consulting on and making recommendations to simplify and improve our law. I'm committed to bringing forward bills to implement its proposals, and the Judicial Factors Bill that we are debating today is one of the SLC bills. It's the third SLC bill to be introduced by the government this session, and those present will know that the recent programme for government included a commitment to bring forward a fourth on the termination of commercial leases. A judicial factor is a person appointed by the court to gather, hold, safeguard and administer property which is not being properly managed. Examples include where there has been a breach of the Law Society accounting rules by a solicitor firm that is or appears likely to be insolvent, and when there is no executor willing to carry out the administration of a deceased person's estate. If passed, the Judicial Factors Bill will put in place an updated and comprehensive framework which will bring clarity, accessibility and efficiency to this vital area of law. A judicial factor is generally an appointment of last resort, made when all other avenues have failed. There are currently around 50 judicial factors appointed to manage someone else's property, and on average, less than 10 court applications for appointments a year. The bill proposes to make important and practical changes for all of those who are involved with judicial factors in one way or another. The appointment of a judicial factor to manage the property of a missing person is an area that came in for close scrutiny by the committee, for which I am grateful. These kinds of appointments have been made in the past, but rarely. Yet 15 people each year are declared long-term missing in Scotland, and the current total is just over 700 people. There will be a number of reasons individual to each of those cases as to why an application for appointment of a judicial factor is not made. One of these might be the difficulty caused by an outdated and complex law. This bill aims to bring the law together in one place to make it easier for users of the legislation. When I gave evidence to the committee earlier this year, I made a commitment to work with the charity Missing People to help produce guidance. This will help the families of those who have gone missing know how to deal with their estate, which might include things like paying the mortgage, managing joint bank accounts, or looking after dependents. And, Presiding Officer, I want to reiterate that commitment here today in the Chamber. In its report, the committee suggested a number of points that should be covered in guidance, and I'll make sure that these are included. An important issue that came out in evidence and on which the committee commented was making sure that it is competent to appoint a judicial factor to the estate of a missing person. Now, Section 3 of the bill is deliberately widely drafted and already allows a judicial factor to be appointed over the estate of a missing person. Appointments of a judicial factor over the estate of a missing person are rare, but they have been made in the past. The bill will not change the legal position. I've listened to the views expressed, however, and together with the guidance that we will prepare, we will also expand on the detail in the explanatory notes to make clear that a judicial factor can be appointed to manage the estate of a missing person. The committee also raised a number of other matters in its Stage 1 report. Yes?
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Minister to take an intervention on that point. The committee were quite explicit about the requirement they felt that should go within the body of the bill. And I understand the commitment from the government both to the guidance and also to the explanatory note, which courts could rely on as evidence of the intention of the bill. But could the minister explain, perhaps more clearly, let me put it that way, why a simple endorsement within the bill to give satisfaction to those families of people that are missing is proving such a challenge?
Minister, I can give you time back.
Thank you. Yes, such an amendment, in my view, is not only unnecessary, but could actually risk undermining the wider policy regarding the circumstances in which the judicial factor may be appointed. Now, Section 3 of the bill is deliberately wide-drafted, as I said in my opening speech, and there already allows for a judicial factor to be appointed over a state of a missing person. So amendment specifically related to missing people could cast doubt on the generality of this section and prevent the appointment of a judicial factor in other circumstances. Presiding Officer, the committee also raised a number of other matters in Stage 1 reports, some of which I want to discuss in the time remaining. First, it may be necessary for a factor to seek information from others about the property being managed, such as banks and other financial institutions. Section 12 of the bill confers a power on judicial factors to require information. This includes provision on data protection, which the committee and a number of stakeholders have questioned. Making clear that data protection legislation is not overridden is not unusual in bills and can be useful in providing clarity. However, I have listened carefully and I will table amendments to address the issues raised. At present, the appointments of only some judicial factors are publicised. Publication increases creditor protection and helps to reduce the risk of a third party unknowingly purchasing property in respect of which a judicial factor has been appointed. The bill provides that every appointment of a judicial factor must be recorded in the Register of Inhibitions, which is a searchable database overseen by the Registers of Scotland. Those who gave evidence were of the general view that publication of appointments is desirable and questioned whether a new bespoke register was needed. The committee recommended that the bill should be flexible enough to allow for a change in the register to be used if circumstances warrant it. I welcome the committee's recognition of the importance of registration, and I will bring forward an amendment at stage two that gives effect to its recommendation. I will also speak to the Registers of Scotland and the Law Society of Scotland to consider what can be done to raise awareness of the use of the register in relation to judicial factories so that people know that property is being managed by a judicial factor. A separate issue raised by some stakeholders and the committee is about the fiduciary character of a judicial factor's role and making this clear in the bill. Reading the bill as a whole, I think it is clear that the nature of the judicial factor's role is fiduciary, although the term is not used. The bill requires judicial factors to hold, manage, administer and protect the factory estate for the benefit of the persons with an interest in the estate and to exercise care, prudence and diligence and take professional advice where appropriate. I do, however, think that something can be added to the explanatory notes to make this point clearer to the users of this legislation. Finally, the accountant of court who supervises the work of judicial factors is appointed and employed by the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Services. The bill sets out that the accountant should be appropriately qualified or experienced in law and accounting. There is no requirement that the accountant be formally qualified in both or either discipline, and this is a restatement of the current legal position. It is for the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Services to determine whether the person appointed is the best fit for the role. The committee, with an eye to the flexibility of the legislation, considered that it would be beneficial for the accountant's qualification to be made subject to review and amendment by regulations if necessary, and made recommendations to that effect. I recognise the flexibility that this brings to the bill, and I will bring forward an amendment at stage two. Deputy Presiding Officer, just before I close, I'd like to put on record my thanks to the Scottish Law Commission for the work that they've done into this reform project, those who gave evidence, and to the members and the clerks of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee for their work scrutinising this bill and for its Stage 1 report. And I move this in my name.
Thank you very much indeed. I now call on Stuart McMillan to speak on behalf of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. Around 7 minutes, Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, I'm delighted to speak today as the convener of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, the lead committee for the bill and also for this Stage 1 debate. So I want to also thank the Minister for her helpful reply to the Delegated Powers and Law Reform report and recommendations. Obviously, the Minister just touched upon that in her comments. Now, this is the third Scottish Law Commission bill that the committee has acted as lead committee for in this session, and it's worth reiterating the point that this is a part of the committee's role and remit which members appreciate and also find very much worthwhile. And just a point that I put to the Parliamentary Business Manager this morning, but also want to make the Minister aware that certainly our committee are always very happy to look at SLC bills. It's a point that we have touched upon in the past also. The Scottish Law Commission bills, by design, are really the most eye-catching pieces of legislation for the vast majority of the population. They are less political by nature, but they're all crucially important to ensure that we actually have a statute book that is very much fit for purpose. We do believe that the Commission's role, ensuring the law keeps pace with the way we live and work in Scotland, is very much a worthwhile one. And the resulting legislation, such as the bill we have in front of us today, is hugely important, and even if quietly so. And I pay tribute to the Commission's work on it. I also think the judicial factors, as we are aware, judicial factors are an ancient pre-union institution of the Scottish courts. Now, the Minister did touch upon the explanation as to what that judicial factor is, so I don't have to reiterate that. But the bill updates the main current law on judicial factors, which is Victorian, dating from 1849 and also 1889. But it also repeals some even older acts of sederunt from the Court of Session. Now, the oldest of these dates from 1690. So that perhaps gives members a flavour of the age and background of the Office of the Judicial Factor, and perhaps also why it was a subject appropriate for the Scottish Law Commission's attention. The Commission's work in the area began back in the 1970s, but stepped up a gear in the early 2010s, with its report on which the current bill is based, published in 2013. We were very grateful to the Scottish Law Commission, including its chair, Lady Payton, and former Commissioner Patrick Layden, who led on this report, and also the now former interim Chief Executive, Charles Garland, for coming to give evidence to the committee, as we were grateful to all of the organisations who engaged with us on the bill. I also pay tribute to my committee colleagues for the way that they worked on the bill. All our recommendations were unanimous, and the committee agreed with the general principles of the bill. I also want to thank the Delegate Appeals and Law Reform Clerking Team for their crucial assistance during the Stage 1 process. There are only around 65 active judicial factories in Scotland, and these are cases opened where a judicial factor has been appointed to manage the estate. Now, the number of new appointments is also low, with around only 7 applications for appointment a year. However, we agree with the general consensus of witnesses and those who responded to the call for views that the role of a judicial factor is a necessary one which should be continued. Of course, as with any bill, there are a number of areas we identified where more work may be worthwhile, and I will try to touch upon a couple of the main points briefly. Before doing so, I must also thank the Minister for her response to the committee's Stage 1 report, which I touched upon earlier. But it certainly did agree with a number of the committee's recommendations. I also thank the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service for their helpful response to the report. Now, one area which we must get right is where a judicial factor is appointed to help manage the estate of a missing person. The bill presents an opportunity to help families and loved ones of people who go missing, and perhaps make slightly easier what would inevitably be a stressful and very difficult situation. The charity Missing People gave compelling evidence to the committee, raising important issues like how practical it would be for a layperson, a family member or a friend to be appointed as a judicial factor, a proposition they supported given cost considerations, as opposed to a professional such as a solicitor or accountant who make up the majority of judicial factors at present. Now, what looking after the best interests of a missing person might actually mean in different circumstances and situations, and also what evidence would be required for a court to accept a person is missing. I am encouraged that the Minister has committed to creating guidance specifically on the judicial factors in relation to missing people. Now, we are assured that this will cover many of the issues raised by the committee, and that the Government will engage further with the Missing People charity on this, and that's really crucial in order to get this particular bit right. Now, one specific recommendation that we had was that the bill should include an explicit statement that it is competent to appoint a judicial factor to the estate of a missing person. But we thought that this was important to ensure clarity on this point. Now, I would be grateful if, in the Minister's summing up, the Minister could actually say more about how this actually will be addressed. Now, further, during the Stage 1 scrutiny, we were encouraged by the willingness that we heard from the Government and also the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Services to adapt and also to review processes to make them easier for lay people to navigate, including in relation to making complaints about a judicial factor. And we hope that the implementation of changes follows in a very similar spirit. In its report, the committee also raised issues in relation to how judicial factories are advertised to those who need to know about them through a register, the data protection and the extent to which such law has sometimes been cited as a reason for information not being shared with the judicial factors, and also the need to obtain the Section 104 order from the UK Government to ensure that the bill gives judicial factors the power that they need to operate effectively. Now, these are all important issues in the bill, which I don't have time to go into in depth, but in relation to each, I'm hopeful that the committee's scrutiny will actually affect the positive change between the initial proposal and what the final act will actually look like. Now, as members will be aware, the Section 104 order is a recurring theme in the SLC bills, which is understandable. So I would be grateful if the Minister can provide an update and a summing up with regards to any communication the Scottish Government has had with the UK Government on this matter. Now, one final point that was the issue regarding the McClure solicitors issue and the question as to why a judicial factor wasn't implemented in this instance. The committee evidence on the matter has been very helpful in this regard, and the Regulation of Legal Services Bill also going through the Parliament, it might actually be of more assistance in actually helping protect clients in the future so that they don't have to go through something similar for them. Now, as I said at the start, for some this might not be the most eye-catching bill, but it covers a hugely important part of the legal landscape, and it's time for it to be modernised. And thank you.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. And I call Jeremy Balfour, around 6 minutes. Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In a week's time, we're going to be celebrating the 25th anniversary of this Parliament. And I suspect if you went out to the highways and byways of Scotland and said, what are the most exciting bills that this Parliament has passed in the last 25 years, this or many others that have come through the delegated powers would not make it into the top 10 or even the top 20. However, these bills do make a real difference to real people's lives. And I think, as Stuart McMillan has pointed out, we are seeing a really good progression of these Scottish Law Commission bills coming into law and making a difference in small ways to maybe a small number of people, but making that difference which will help their lives be better. I want to also add my thanks to the Scottish Law Commission for the work that they do, to thank the clerks and to all those that gave evidence to the committee. I was on and off on different occasions when this was going through, but there was, I think, again, as Mr McMillan has pointed out, a real unity in regard to trying to find a way forward in regard to the legislation. We within the Scottish Conservatives recognise the need for reform and appreciate the crucial role judicial factors can play in our legal system. I think all of us want to see the updates and streamlines, and we want to make the legislation better and more efficient. As again has been pointed out by both previous speakers, there are not that many judicial factors. I think between 2022 there were 64 open cases around. But these are important, and we need to make sure that the appropriate services are being offered to those who require this. I also welcome the Minister's response, not only this afternoon, but in her letter to the committee, which I think did put at ease some of the issues that we had raised. And I look forward to scrutinising the Stage 2 amendments that she will bring forward in due course. If, in the time remaining, if I can just highlight two or three areas where I think there still needs to be some clarity in regard to this. The first has been picked on again and by both speakers, and that in regard to missing people. I have to say I didn't fully understand the response from the Minister in regard to the question was asked for her. I think we all have the same end goal. We all want to get to the same place. And I would ask, maybe at stage two, or even if she could write to the committee before then, just to give some more clarification of why this can't be in the bill. Because I think certainly the evidence we took, and I think where the committee were moving towards, was to have that in black and white within the bill. Now, there may well be good reasons, as the Minister tried to explain, of why that isn't possible or would actually have more negative effect. But I certainly, and I'm sure other of my colleagues, would like a bit more understanding around that. I do appreciate that it's not within scope for this bill the role of the accountant of court. As somebody who is perhaps old-fashioned, I do think probably to have an accountancy or legal qualification would be helpful. And I do think some of the recommendations that have been brought forward should be looked at stage two. One of the major roles for judicial factor, and fortunately doesn't happen very often, is in regard to when a legal firm gets itself into financial trouble. I welcome the input from the Law Society of Scotland, and I do think we just have to make sure that the law is updated enough to make sure that clients, as Mr McMillan has pointed out, are protected properly when, on the rare occasions, a judicial factor is appointed. Finally, I think there is a very helpful section within the report around charities and charity law. I think, again, there seems to be consensus around that, and I look forward to seeing any changes that are brought forward in regard to that. I think we have a good bill. I think we can make it a wee bit better at stage two and stage three. And I look forward to working with the Minister and with colleagues to making sure that happens. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. I now call Martin Whitfield around 5 minutes, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I immediately start by echoing what everyone else has with my thanks to the Law Commission and indeed to the committee and to their clerks and indeed to the government with the prompt response to this. It may not be the most interesting bill, but like so many uninteresting bills, if it happens to affect you, it suddenly becomes a very important part of your life. And I think one of the crucial roles that this Parliament serves is to try and protect people and to give as much support and guidance at times of challenge, irrespective of the number, irrespective of the frequency that it needs to come before us. And I think this bill, as others have echoed, takes a number of steps in the right direction. I would like to pick up on the intervention that I made with regard to the missing person, because I do have concerns about this, and I understand and heard the Minister's response, which on my interpretation reads that we have a general section that the government are confident covers missing people. However, we're going to express that in potentially the memorandum and in guidance, just to make sure everyone knows, but we're not going to put it into the bill just in case we limit the broad nature of Section 3. I don't find that a strong argument, with all respect. I think we are talking about a group of people for whom life, when this addresses to them, is incredibly conflicting on so many levels. And one of the real challenges that's never expected is the practicalities of how property is handled, how contracts are handled, how bank accounts are handled. And indeed, it is an area that throughout the history of factors has always been there on the edge. And I think we have an opportunity here and now with this bill at the appropriate stage to absolutely clarify the situation, not to exclude anything else that the government are anticipating, but to make sure that those who inadvertently find themselves in the need of this are given the clearest support to understand that the Judicial Factors Act is there, not to take over from them, not to support. And I would like to echo the convener, in particular the response from the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, that actually the practicality of this can be spoken in a language that's understandable. Support is there, and it would be useful. So I would press the government to explain further their positioning on it, because I see this becoming something that returns with regard to this bill, and I think it's possibly something that, indeed, across the chamber, with the committee's input, there can be a way through without it becoming a problem. And I would like to thank the Law Society for their response in regard to this. And in particular, I would point out that they were in agreement. They would welcome the recommendations that this is specifically appears within the bill. And I think that's a powerful reason to look at it again and to discuss it. The other aspect that I would like to raise, which may be a challenge to address this afternoon, but I would be more than happy to receive correspondence on this matter, and I simply do so because of my always ongoing interest with regard to the safeguarding of children. One of the aspects was the Children Scotland Act 1995, and the proposals that were contained in the original 2019 consultation don't appear in this bill. The purpose of that was, in essence, to protect the role where property owned by children is being handled by a factor and the safeguarding that's required to ensure that that's not being exploited. Given the subsequent passing of the UNCRC in this chamber, I think it would be not inappropriate for the government to express, and I'm more than happy for this to be in writing, why this has not been pursued at this matter. I welcome this bill. I welcome the attempt to put right that mix of statutory and common law that crashes together over the centuries, as the committee convener pointed out. And I do think this is an opportunity which, with respect to the hard work that the Law Commission do, we should take every opportunity to make sure the bill that leaves this place is as fit for purpose this year as it is for next, as it is perhaps for the next 300 or 400 years. I am grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, for your patience.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. I now call Maggie Chapman, around 4 minutes, Ms. Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to extend my thanks to the Scottish Law Commission, the committee members and clerks, and those who responded to the various consultations on this legislation, especially the charity Missing People. The meticulous, informed and considered work by all those involved has been both impressive and encouraging, and I hope that in these formal stages to come, we can speak and act with the same level of wisdom and empathy. I don't suppose there will be many people screaming from the rooftops or many headlines about this debate and the bill we are considering this afternoon. Most people, I imagine, go through their lives without ever encountering a judicial factor. It's a shame, perhaps, that the chamber isn't packed with journalists eagerly reporting every one of our speeches, because the subject of this afternoon's proceedings is a salutary example of what the Scottish Parliament can do quietly and steadily, without fanfare or grandstanding, with real cooperation across this chamber and with other institutions, other bodies and wider civil society. The work of the Scottish Law Commission, is hugely important for the development of responsible, relevant justice in Scotland. Its law reform recommendations allow us to combine the unique traditions of Scots law with policy and process that meet the needs of people and communities today, and as Martin Whitfield has already indicated, hopefully into the future too. That's illustrated by the work done for this bill by the Commission and the Committee in exploring ways that the appointment of a judicial factor can help in a range of difficult situations. One such is when a person goes missing, for they leave behind them, with their families and friends, not only anxiety, pain, loss and uncertainty, but practical difficulties in managing financial matters. Missing People offers a lifeline both to those missing or thinking about going missing and those affected by a disappearance. Many members here, like me, will know of people whose lives have been saved by their sensitive and painstaking work. Missing People have engaged closely with the development of this bill, recognising how the appointment of a judicial factor might be a way of enabling families to deal effectively and efficiently with some of those financial issues arising from a disappearance. I understand that the bill hasn't been able to do everything that they had hoped for, but I warmly welcome the commitments by the Scottish Government to work with Missing People to address those outstanding issues, including in the development of appropriate guidance and procedures. But I do support the committee's call for changes on the face of the bill to make its applicability to families affected by disappearance absolutely explicit. And I too would be interested in the Minister's remarks to this, on this point. In working to make the bill's processes as straightforward and seamless as possible, we of course need to acknowledge that not all relevant relationships will be within Scotland or concerned with devolved matters. So I therefore welcome the ongoing discussions by the Scottish Government with the UK Government about the potential for a Section 104 order, obliging UK ministers and bodies dealing with reserved matters to provide information on the same basis as those within devolved powers. To conclude, Presiding Officer, and on behalf of the Scottish Greens, I welcome this bill and look forward to working with others in this chamber and beyond to help make it as valuable as possible in addressing the needs of people and communities in Scotland today and the future. Thank you.
Thank you. And we move to the open debate, and I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a substitute member of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, I'm pleased to be speaking in today's important debate. Presiding Officer, on the face of it, as others have said, this bill presents as pretty dry and technical, but as is always the way, it's actually vital to ordinary citizens in lots of ways. Judicial factors are appointed by courts to look after property belonging to someone else. They can also be appointed to oversee a solicitor's firm where there's been a breach of the Law Society of Scotland's accounting rules, or where a sole practitioner dies. They may also be appointed to wind up the estate of a deceased person or to oversee charity property or the estate of a missing person. Essentially, they do the background work which many of us may need at some point in our lives. Presiding Officer, the fact is, as we've heard, the law relating to judicial factors is in desperate need of modernisation. The existing legislation dates back to the 19th century and is now regarded by those who use it as outdated. At present, the majority of individuals appointed as judicial factors are legal and financial professionals. The Scottish Government has set out a key policy objective for the reforms, creating a comprehensive regime in one piece of legislation, and I welcome this. It is long overdue. The bill introduces a statutory framework that sets out clearly the essential features of the Office of Judicial Factor and the broad parameters within which it should operate. It aims to bring clarity, accessibility and efficiency. In 2010, the Scottish Law Commission published a discussion paper on judicial factors in which it analysed the existing law, and in 2013, the SLC published its recommendations for reform of the law. In 2019, the Scottish Government consulted on the SLC's recommendations and the current procedure for the appointment of judicial factors in cases of missing persons. Presiding Officer, one of the elements I mentioned earlier was the support this bill can give to the family of a missing person, and Martin Whitfield has just mentioned that. The distress of this situation is unimaginable, and that's why this bill and the support it will offer is so important. In addition to the emotional distress, practical implications for family members, such as having to deal with their property and financial affairs while they're missing, it must be heartbreaking. In these cases, judicial factors can be appointed to manage the missing person's estate to relieve that stress. And I'm really pleased that the Scottish Government has committed to working with the charity Missing People to prepare guidance for people who are considering appointing a judicial factor to manage the estate of a missing person. I think this is to be greatly welcomed, and it confirms the measured and committed way the Government is addressing this. The Bill doesn't make a provision about what evidence is required to satisfy a court that an appointment should be made, as rightly this will depend on the circumstances of every case. A theme running through the Committee's consideration of the Bill was the Bill's application to situations where a judicial factor is appointed or might be appointed to manage the estate of a charity. The Scottish Government have started consultations with stakeholders about proposed changes sought by the Charity Law Association ahead of bringing forward any Stage 2 amendments that may be needed in this area. And again, this is a very important provision. The Minister has advised that she would write to the committee ahead of Stage 2 to confirm the Government's intentions when this engagement is complete. Presiding Officer, a clear, accessible complaints handling route is vital. It's not on the face of the bill, but the Scottish Government will work with the SCTS and the Accountant of Court to make sure that information on how to make a complaint about a judicial factor is clearly accessible. Overall, a majority of respondents to the committee's consultation supported the SLC's recommendations, confirming that there is a need for existing legislation to be updated. And the bill takes forward without amendment the majority of the SLC's recommendations for reform. So, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, this is a good and very necessary bill, and I thoroughly recommend that it passes at stage one. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Oliver Mundell to be followed by Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm having a slightly strange day for me in that I've sat through the previous education statement and found myself agreeing with almost everything the Cabinet Secretary said. And then, and I hope this is taken in good spirit, I come to this debate and agreed almost entirely with Maggie Chapman. Because I think she's right, and I think to a degree Jeremy Balfour's right at the start of the debate. I think these Scottish Law Commission bills and the work of the DPLR committee actually do show this Parliament at its best and show what good committee scrutiny is like. It's easy within that committee because the things by their very nature are far less political, but having been a past member of that committee and moved to the ever so exciting Standards Committee, and maybe in the time I have left here, I'll get to go onto a different committee and kind of take that knowledge to it. Because having been on some of the more political subject committees in the past, I think that work sometimes gets lost in amongst the politics. So I think it's good that we've got this process up and running and working well, because as other members have said, these areas of law are really important to those they affect, and they're also areas that have been neglected for a long time. And that would maybe lead me to the one area where I think the Minister could go further, which has again been referenced already by other speakers, in terms of missing people, because I think I understand the point she's making in relation to Section 3 and whether or not that's the right place to include a reference to missing people. I'm open to hearing more, but I think there's a danger if we don't put a requirement to produce the guidance. I know the Minister, like members of the committee, was very convinced by the evidence we heard, but you know, we don't know into the future how this area of law is going to evolve. There are lots of other mechanisms within the bill as proposed that would allow for changes in the future, and I wonder whether there's space somewhere else for a requirement to produce that missing persons guidance and to review it periodically to make sure that it continues to be effective, and that that might be an alternative. Let's take the intervention.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank Oliver Mundell for taking the intervention, and I'm sure Mr Mundell was in the committee at the time when we looked at this, but I think it's just a point of kind of fact just for all in the chamber that when we were producing the report, the stage one report from the committee, I think it's fair to say that we had a lot of discussion and debate around the missing people issue, because the evidence that we heard was extremely compelling, very powerful, and we wanted to ensure that the committee report very much reflected that, and also to also help that help the government when it comes to any potential amendments going forward.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the convener for that intervention, and I'm looking at page 10 of the report at recommendation 56. And you know, I know the wording that was agreed and remember being there when it was being discussed, but the committee was indicating a strong preference for it to be included in the bill, but we said that we didn't have a strong preference for how it should be added. You know, and I think that's one of the advantages of going through this staged process, is there's still time to have another look at that, because obviously having an inclusion within the explanatory notes is a step forward for a group of people, families, you know, and organisations representing them who often feel they're not at the centre of policy, that because of the small numbers of people affected and the whole complexity around that, then you know, this is probably not even the most significant issue for those families, having something concrete would be a starting point, but I think we can do a little bit better than that based on the evidence we heard. But I'm conscious, Presiding Officer, I'm coming to the end of my time, and I look forward to hearing from the Minister a little bit more on that area and on some of the other points that she's offered to revisit. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Bill Kidd, to be followed by Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and a quick thanks also to the clerking and legal teams on the DPLR committee. They do a fantastic job. The Judicial Factors Scotland Bill is a critical step forward in modernising and streamlining our legal framework. This bill is not just a technical adjustment, it is a vital piece of legislation that will help bring clarity, accessibility and efficiency to an area of law that has long been in need of reform. The existing legislation on judicial factors dates back to the 19th century, a time when the legal landscape was vastly different from what we know today. Just ask Stuart McMillan. Those working within this area of law, I enjoyed that one, I don't know about anybody else. Those working within this area of law, whether legal professionals or the individuals directly affected, have long highlighted how outdated the current system is. Procedures have become cumbersome and convoluted and no longer fit for purpose in today's Scotland. The Judicial Factors Scotland Bill addresses these concerns head-on with reforms that reflect the modern legal environment and the needs of the people it serves. The primary aim of this bill is to create a comprehensive regime, consolidating the scattered and outdated provisions into one clear, accessible piece of legislation. It introduces a statutory framework that sets out the essential features of the Office of the Judicial Factor and the broad parameters within which it should operate. By doing so, we simplify and streamline the process, making it more efficient and less intimidating for those who need it most. Judicial factors play a vital role in safeguarding property and estates in complex situations, whether it's stepping in to manage the affairs of a deceased individual, a missing person, or in cases where a solicitor's firm has breached the Law Society of Scotland accounting rules, the role of the judicial factor is indispensable. While the number of appointments may have decreased in recent years, this bill acknowledges that there is still a continuing need for judicial factors, particularly in certain complex and sensitive cases. One of the key elements of this bill is a provision it makes for the families of missing persons. As we know, the emotional and practical burdens that fall on families when a loved one goes missing are immense. This bill ensures that judicial factors can be appointed to manage the estate of a missing person, conserving their assets and protecting their interests until they return or are declared deceased. This will bring a much-needed relief to families who, in addition to their emotional distress, may face financial and administrative challenges. Another important aspect of this bill is its application to the estates of charities. We have heard from stakeholders such as OSCR, that's the Office of the Scottish Charity Regulator, who have expressed support for this bill. The Scottish Government's ongoing consultations with stakeholders, including the Charity Law Association, will ensure that any necessary amendments are made at stage two, ensuring the bill's provisions are as robust and effective as possible. Presiding Officer, this bill builds upon years of careful consideration and consultation, beginning with the Scottish Law Commission's recommendations back in 2013 and continuing through extensive engagement with stakeholders in recent years. It's a thoughtful and considered piece of legislation that will benefit not just legal professionals, but individuals, families and charities across Scotland. In conclusion, this bill is long overdue. It brings our laws into the 21st century, ensuring they are fit for purpose and can meet the challenges of modern Scotland. By providing clarity, accessibility and efficiency, the Judicial Factors Scotland Bill will make a real difference to those who rely on the vital role of judicial factors. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Ben McPherson, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And like others, I want to speak in favour of this important bill, which will put in place an updated and comprehensive regime which will bring much needed and overdue, some would argue, clarity, accessibility and efficiency to this vital but outmoded area of law. And I should refer colleagues to my member's register of interest as still being on the role of Scottish solicitors. And as others have said, especially I thought the convener made an excellent speech setting out the evidence that had been taken at stage one and the diligent work that the committee have done. But this law if passed by Parliament through the various stages, is of course about service. It's about making sure that those who are affected in the scenarios where the law would apply is both more effective than what is in place at the moment and sensitive to the needs of particularly the loved ones of missing persons. But also it's about making sure that both the utilisation of the law and the application of the law in an effective way is greater facilitated. And having been somebody in the past who advised on complex areas of law, the more that the law is usable by solicitors, the better the service, and particularly in times of sensitivity, the better the service can be. So I think this is an important piece of legislation in that it will help those who are engaged in providing professional advice and then also those who are receiving their advice. And the fact that this is a consolidating bill as well is something to be welcomed. And actually, obviously, this is quite a specific example because of the historic nature of the current legislation and the fact that it really does need tidied up from over quite a long period of time, to say the least. We're talking centuries here, from what the convener said. But actually consolidating pieces of legislation, I think, is something that we as a Parliament probably want to think a bit more about in the period ahead. And the fact that the Scottish Law Commission have brought this forward, who I think do extremely good work, and their thoughtfulness, their expertise, their diligence, and the way that they work through, you know, every eventuality using all of their experience and insight, means that what they bring to us, to this chamber, to the people of Scotland, is in the vast majority of cases, you know, really things that we want to pick up and to make sure that we legislate and legislate well and get on the statute book. So for all the reasons that have been said, and also to help those of my former profession in their work going forward, I'd be happy to support this bill at stage one.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In closing for the Scottish Greens, I'd like to reiterate my thanks to all those who have worked so hard, so cooperatively and so effectively on the long process since that first discussion paper of 2010 of bringing this bill so far. I'm grateful to members for their positive contributions to the debate and heartened to see such wide-ranging examples of cross-party consensus. It goes to show that there really is a first time for everything, Mr. Mundell. Many of the debates about this bill are not so much about its substantive provisions, but about what needs to be explicitly stated and what is already the case under existing law. Those judgments have to be made in relation to issues as various as data protection and the power to choose environmentally sustainable and socially just investments. We've heard about how little the Office of Judicial Factor has been used over recent years, and how the complexity and in some cases antiquity of previous legislation has contributed to its rarity. But we can hope that once this bill becomes law, people will not only know that judicial factors exist, but that they can help with some very contemporary problems. We've heard about the flexibility of the proposed legislation, the way in which it recognises that a judicial factor acting to protect the clients of a solicitor's firm, a judicial factor paying a missing family member's mortgage, and a judicial factor winding up a deceased person's estate may be very different people carrying out very different tasks. And we've heard about what else needs to be done, what amendments, guidance, and further action the committee and others are seeking in order to make this bill as effective, its processes as transparent, and its implementation as thorough as it can possibly be. The issues relating to missing people, of cost and complexity, of the situation when the missing person returns, and of the interrelationship with the Presumption of Death Act, particularly, I think, demand our attention and our care. We in the Scottish Greens look forward to these developments and will do what we can to support them. This bill brings long-standing legal traditions into our contemporary context, asking and answering the questions, how can we learn from the past and how can we do justice here, now and for future generations? I know we all will seek to do our best to get those answers right. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Katie Clark.
Scottish Labour supports this Law Commission bill, which we regard as non-controversial. We note that the Law Society of Scotland agree that the law relating to judicial factors is in need of modernisation, are supportive of the bill and an up-to-date codification of this area of law, and, as Ben McPherson says, a consolidation bill. As the Minister indicated, an area the committee focused on was missing people, and I welcome the commitment from the Minister to continue to work with those involved in this issue, the Charity for Missing People. We thank the committee for all the work they've done on this bill and for their Stage 1 report, which clearly outlines the issues. We agree that the role of judicial factor is a necessary one and one that needs to continue. As the convener said, it is important that we get the law in relation to a judicial factor for a missing person right. I was pleased that the convener, who of course has been heavily involved in the McClure's issue as a constituency MSP, raised whether a judicial factor should have been appointed in that situation. Like him, I have been consulted by a number of constituents who have lost huge amounts of money as a result of the actions of McClure's, and it will be interesting to hear if the Minister believes that this bill might have made a difference if it had been legislation previously. As many speakers said, there have actually been very few judicial factors. However, we need to ensure that the law is updated enough to deal with such situations, such as where solicitors' firms get into financial difficulties. Martin Whitfield raised more than once the issue of missing people and the failure to make specific provisions on the face of the bill. Oliver Mundell also spoke to this point, and the convener confirmed that this was a significant point that the committee considered. I hope that the Minister will clarify whether an amendment will be forthcoming from the Scottish Government to put specific provisions on the face of the bill. Rona Mackay said that the bill was dry and technical. However, like Maggie Chapman, she spoke about how important this bill could be to individuals. She pointed out that it had taken 11 years since the Commission made recommendations, perhaps because of how few cases there actually are in reality, and also spoke about how important it was now that there was engagement prior to Stage 2. I looked very carefully at what the Law Society of Scotland have said about this bill. They are very clear that they support the committee's conclusion that a complaints process for judicial factors does not need to be included on the face of the bill, and we would accept their view on that issue. They are, however, supportive of steps to improve the accessibility and signposting to existing complaints mechanisms and welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to make that recommendation forward. They also took the view that the bill preserved the jurisdiction of the Court of Session for applications to appoint a judicial factor and that this was the correct approach. However, they did seek clarification on the proposed interaction between this bill and the Adults with Incapacity Scotland Act 2000, and also suggested that a power to appoint a substitute judicial factor should be added to this bill. It would be helpful if the Minister could respond to these points either today or indeed as the bill process continues. The Law Society also took the view that the exclusion of certain UK bodies from the duty to comply with a notice issued by a judicial factor or indeed their accountant of court would adversely impact on the ability to obtain relevant information. And so we welcome the Scottish Government's intention to explore extending that. We also welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to clarify or remove references to data protection legislation in these sections of the bill. There were a couple of points that I was going to ask the Minister to respond on. The committee highlighted that the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Services evidence indicated that there could be a cost of £380,000 if the bill did not get royal assent, and it would be useful if the Minister could respond to that. And the Minister also said in committee that the report, that they were looking at how the bill could be amended at stage two to capture the way that complaints in a professional body could be made in the context of solicitors and regulated professions. And again, it would be useful if the Minister could respond on this point. It is extremely positive to take part in a debate where there's so much consensus in the Chamber, and we look forward to a positive debate as we go forward to try to make sure that we get the best possible law in this area. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, and I call on Tim Eagle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I agree, actually. I mean, I haven't been here very long, but I mean, I would have thought more consensual debates happen more often, but maybe not. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am delighted to close this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives after it actually has been a very gentle and kind Thursday afternoon debate. Can I add my thanks to the Delegated Powers and Law and Reforms Committees, clerks and advisers for all of their work on the bill. It really was outstanding. And to all of those who gave evidence during our scrutiny of the bill. As my colleagues Jeremy Balfour and Oliver Mundell have said, we support the Bill's intention to reform, update and consolidate the legislation on judicial factors. Now, I probably could stop there and just say ditto to Katie Clarke's, because I think I must have got a copy of your speech, because I think mine was pretty much identical. But I'll just pick up on a few of the points. The first one was around the law reform backlog. I think this bill... Originally, there was the Scottish Law Commission published a discussion paper on this in 2010, full recommendations in 2013, but obviously we're now in 2024. Now, I welcome the Minister and I think Stuart McMillan as well saying that there was going to be more of these bills coming through, and I think that would be a good thing to get all these sorts of things, because they do matter. You know, these little things might not be of great interest, but they do matter to the people of which require them. So I'm looking forward to that coming. On missing people, I don't think I can add much to what is said, Minister, but I would say through yourself, Presiding Officer, to the Minister, there does seem to be a consensus around the need for something in the bill, and I do hope that the Minister will go back and speak with her advisers on that, because I think it would be good if the government could bring that forward at stage two and that we could all coalesce around that rather than leave it out. It is a very important thing, and Martin Whitfield, Oliver Mundell, Katie Clarke all raised that amongst others here today. Complaints procedure. The committee examined the complaints procedure quite thoroughly during the stage one scrutiny, following the suggestion from the Faculty of Procurators of Caithness that it could be strengthened. Now, while the committee concluded that it was content with the current system of complaints as a sensible compromise, we would also like to see the Scottish Government, the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service and the Accountant of Court work to improve access to information about the complaints process. It's just back to that other thing, isn't it? We've just got to make sure that it's as accessible as possible for the very few times that it is actually required. Now, I want to pick up on the point around the Law Societies of Scotland's in-house judicial factor. The committee read the notes from the Faculty of Procurators of Caithness argument set out in their written evidence against the Law Society of Scotland having an in-house judicial factor and the power to appoint that judicial factor in certain circumstances. Now, having listened to the evidence, we were pretty content that that was perfectly fine to do, and it was fine for the Law Society's authorities the ability to petition to appoint its in-house judicial factor, having accepted that there are adequate avenues for anyone opposed to that to do so in court, and that there are processes available in the complaint system. But I do want to kind of say on record, at least to highlight that point, that with that that has some great responsibility that comes with it, and I urge the Law Society to always remember that when they've got covering those two bases. There was some debate during the committee's evidence session with regards to the creation of a standalone register for judicial factors. The committee finally settled on compromise and agreed to the proposal in the bill to register judicial factors in the Register of Inhibitions. And I welcome the Minister's opening remarks that said they will bring forward an amendment at stage two to look at the periodic review of that, if I've got that correct. So, in summing up, Presiding Officer, this law reform I think is very welcome. It will be very important to those that see it. I thank the DPLR and the Minister and welcome the approval of this at stage one this evening.
Thank you. And I call on Siobhan Brown to wind up, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And and I'd like to thank all the members for their contributions to this afternoon's debate. I'd like to repeat my thanks to the Scottish Law Commission for the work that has gone into this project and to the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee for its work gathering and responding to the evidence for the bill. A few of those in the chamber today may remember last year debating reform of trust law, the principal statute, which dated back from 1921. The Office of Judicial Factor has an equally long history in Scots law, as Stuart McMillan has said in his speech, and the most recent statutes dedicated to the office date from 1849 to 1889. Included in this year's legislative programme is a bill implementing the SLC's recommendation on the termination of leases and notice to quit, one of the principal pieces of statute in that area that dates from 1756, although it was reenacted as recently as 1913. Presiding Officer, clearly progress is being made in updating our laws, and as Maggie Chapman did highlight, there is some really important work that's going on in the Scottish Government and Parliament, and sometimes this just is not recognised. If the bill is passed by Parliament, this will put in place a modern and broad framework which sets out the essential features of the role and its supervision. This will bring clarity, accessibility and efficiency to the area, which might hopefully mean that the solution of appointing a judicial factor is utilised in a wider range of circumstances. I think the SLC's recommendations achieve the aim of setting out a modern framework for the appointment of the supervision of judicial factors. The committee and members here today have identified points of detail where they consider that improvements can be made to the bill, which I'll take away and reflect on, and I will come to some of the points later on my speech. But I am willing to listen to and, where I can, work with members across this chamber on this bill. And despite these points of difference, however, I am pleased to hear from across the chamber that there is broad support for the general principles of the bill. Presiding Officer, I'd like to use what time I have left to discuss a few issues that have been raised this afternoon, and there are actually quite a few. So, first of all, I'll move on to missing people, and I know most members have commented on that, and due to the compelling evidence that the committee did take, I understand that it is an emotive issue. On missing persons, we don't create legislation in a vacuum. We must take into account the rules of statutory interpretation, and as I've said, adding something to the bill to make clear that a judicial factor can be appointed over the estate of a missing person could mean that the court does not agree to appoint a judicial factor in other circumstances. So it is a risk that is considered not necessary, but I am listening to members and my door is always open if they wish to discuss this further with me. If we move on to the charity, which I know Jeremy Balfour did raise, judicial factors can be appointed in a wide range of circumstances, and I know suggestions have been made by some stakeholders for possible amendments about circumstances where a judicial factor is appointed to manage the estate of a charity, and I am exploring these. I'll write to the committee ahead of stage two to confirm my intentions when engagement with the relevant stakeholders is finished. Martin Whitfield, just in your point of safeguarding Children's Act, I will write to you on that if that's okay. Thank you. And on, I know it was raised, the Section 104 orders with communication with the UK Government. Most of the bill's provision will only apply in Scotland. However, there are certain provisions that I think should apply in the rest of the UK as well. The aim is to ensure that a judicial factor appointed on an estate is able to exercise their functions in relation to the whole of the estate, regardless of where the property is in the United Kingdom. Intergovernmental arrangements are in place to manage the delivery of orders that require to be made under the Section 104 of the Scotland Act 1988, and officials are in discussion with the UK Government about seeking a Section 104 order for this bill, and these discussions so far have been positive, and this work will continue as the bill progresses, and I will keep the Parliament updated on progress of this work. Katie Clark and Stuart McMillan highlighted McClure's solicitors. Generally, under the Solicitors Scotland Act 1980, The Law Society of Scotland can apply to the court for an appointment of a judicial factor to a solicitor firm in certain circumstances. Such a judicial factor does not carry out any legal work in the way of an incoming firm is able to do in many cases, and it may be preferable for another firm to take over the business of a failing firm rather than a judicial factor be put in place. So ultimately, it is up to the Law Society as a regulator that would be generally best placed to decide whether or not an appointment of a judicial factor to a solicitor's firm. But the Scottish Government has taken proactive steps to mitigate against the situation of McClure's happening in the future. You'll be aware my other bill, which is proceeding through Parliament, is a Regulation of Legal Services Scotland Bill, which introduces the authorisation of legal businesses, bringing benefits such as greater consistency in regulating legal firms, enabling the Law Society of Scotland as the regulator to identify and address deficiencies early. Tim Eagle brought up the point that the Faculty of Procurators of Caithness highlighted to the committee, and I welcome the committee's view that this system is a sensible approach with the complaints procedure. I've listened to what was said about the accessibility of the complaints procedure, and officials will work with CSTS and the Accountant of Court to make sure that information on how to make a complaint about a judicial factor is clearly accessible. Katie Clark, you mentioned Royal Assent. I do not have any information that it will not get Royal Consent, but I will keep you updated if that is a problem moving forward. And also the point you raised regarding the Law Society briefing that came through to all of us, they did raise quite a few technical aspects of this bill. So my officials have reached out to them when we receive this, and we're meeting them next week to discuss that, to go through. So I believe today's debate reinforces the impression that there is broad support for the bill and for its policy aims. Parliament has an opportunity to look at and consider an area of law which does not normally rise to prominence, but it is of vital importance to those that need it and to rely on it, whether that is to distribute a deceased person's estate or manage a missing person's property. As a whole, the bill seeks to bring the law up to date and takes forward all the substantive recommendations for reform proposed by the Scottish Law Commission. I'd like to thank the members who have contributed to today's debate, and I welcome your broad support for the general principles of the bill, as the debate has indicated. However, there are matters to consider and some differences of view on some points of detail, and I look forward to working with the committee and members from across the chamber to consider these issues in the coming weeks. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Judicial Factors Scotland Bill at Stage 1. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, and I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are, and there's one question to be put as a result of today's business, and the question is that motion 14485 in the name of Siobhan Brown on Judicial Factors Scotland Bill be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. The motion is therefore agreed, and that concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.